I discovered contemporary dance at age 24. I was teaching literature in a college in Granby, and a colleague of mine invited me to a summer workshop given by Groupe Nouvelle Air. Martine Époque was the artistic director at that moment. So I went to attend this summer school. And I fell madly in love with the art form and with the people. At the end of the 3 weeks, Martine Époque said to me that I had talent, that I was talented, that I should become a dancer. And so I did not believe her. I had a full-time job at the university, and not at the university, but at the college. She said that I was talented, so I said, okay, let's pay her a visit in Montreal and check if she was serious or not. And she told me she was extremely serious. So from then on, I did attend the school of Groupe Nouvelle Air in Montreal. I was commuting every day between Granby and Montreal to do my training with the school. And not long after, I was allowed in the company class, and then I started to perform small roles, but I started to perform with them. So it kept going like this for about 5 years, and then I left my teaching. I left my full-time job at I left my full-time job at the Cégep, and I became a full-time dancer. Groupe Nouvelle Air was extremely adventurous in a way that Martine Époque was extremely open. She was telling her dancers, if you want to choreograph, please do. Don't wait until you think you are a choreographer. If you want to experiment, please do. So I'd the idea to do a duet with Ginette Lorrain, and this was my first piece in 1978. And the same year, I did the first piece of Edward Locke entitled T'envoler. And not long after that, I danced in a piece for Daniel Léveillé. So this group was extremely prolific in terms of young creators, and as I said, the door was open for us to experiment, so this was quite exciting. And at the same time in Montreal, there was this kind of can I say movement towards independent choreographers. So there were so many young people from all various training and various interests in life and things that became choreographed and started their own, many started their own company. I was having my own company, and then I thought, no, I cannot, I will not survive if I have to come up with a new program every year as a choreographer. So I had the idea of creating Montréal Danse, which would be a repertoire company for contemporary dance. And I think that when I created this Montréal Danse in 1986, I was like 20 or if not 40 years ahead of my time. I think it would be time now to have to create a repertoire company in order to preserve the works of as many choreographers, as many contemporary choreographers as we can. And so in the mid-80s, I think it was just way too early to do such a project. And then in the mid-80s, I decided to accept the proposal from Youakam to teach full-time at the dance department, which I did for 10 years from 89 to 99. This was a very rich experience because passing on your knowledge to students is always very challenging and very exciting.
Thank you.
did that teaching, university teaching for 10 years. And of course, while I was teaching, my company was a bit lower key, although I did create the three major solos that starting with Les Malheurs, La Tentation de la Transparence, and Bras de Plomb, which the last two I did with Betty Goodwin, the visual artist, the an extraordinary artist, who I was so happy to collaborate with. I had the nerve to call her and say, "Mrs. Goodwin, I would like to talk to you about a project." This was about La Tentation, and Mrs. Goodwin was very kind with me. And after I told her everything about the work I wanted to do, she said, "You don't need me. You know exactly where you are going and what you will achieve." So, and during that time, I was presenting Les Malheurs, so I sent her an invitation, and she kindly said yes. She came to see the performance, and after the performance, I was in the dressing room, and knock, knock, knock. Who's there? Betty Goodwin, coming to say yes, Paul-André, we'll work together. So this was the beginning of our collaboration for two major works. I think that the platform she designed for La Tentation is extraordinary. It's now exposed. It now belongs to the archives of the NAC in Ottawa. And Bras de Plomb, for which she created a set that is just mesmerizing. This set now belongs to the gallery in the Mackenzie Gallery in Regina, which is I'm very happy with that because this set is preserved for forever, and I think it's such a major creation of hers that it's very important. And for me, it's always been very challenging and exciting to work with visual artists. It did start very early in my career. In the mid-60s at Groupe Nouvelle Air, we were doing what we called les corps-échanges, and we did invite the pioneers, Françoise Riopel, Jeanne Renaud, and Françoise Sullivan, to remount works and to teach us about their time, the late 40s. And I did learn a lot about the automatist artists. And I became a friend of Françoise, and of course she had an extraordinary influence on my work because Françoise always told me, "You do it for you first, you don't have to please anybody. You just it's your work. You have to progress at your rhythm." And I trust her, and I did what I wanted to do, not what the others wanted me to do. And I'm very grateful to her to have taught me that. And also throughout my career, I did work with many, many great artists, visual artists, composers, cinema people, and it's always been a challenge because when you work with someone you admire, it pushes you to places where you would not go on yourself, on your own. So it become my way of working to surround myself with people I really admire because the challenge was so strong. So and I think that I am the artist I am because I did challenge myself with such frequentations. Talking about 40 years of creation, of course, there are moments that are more strong than others, and I think that what I'll never the most interesting part of my career, as far as I'm concerned, is my solo career, which started quite late with La Tentation, then from then on, I considered myself as almost as a solo performer, and it culminated with Solo 30-30, a 30-minute solo dance that I was performing outside, rain or shine, usually in a very in difficult conditions, in somewhere in town that was not very attractive, and I was dancing sometimes for many, many people, and some other time just for two people. And I've learned so much doing that solo. I've learned so much about the audience, the intelligence of the audience, the generosity of an audience, the proximity of an audience. I could see tears running down cheeks while I was performing. So then it tells you why you are performing. The rapport to the people was extremely, extremely intimate. And I think it's the most beautiful thing I've done in my life. I performed that piece 450 times on three continents, in small towns, big towns, in Asia, in Europe, in America. So it's the piece that taught me the most about the rapport between the artist and the audience. So I'm very lucky I had the idea of doing that piece, and having the possibility to do it for so long. That was a gift. You know, when you work with great artists, what I look for, it's a kind of illumination, a kind of state of excitement that is permanent throughout the work, and it elevates me, it elevates everyone. We all learn from each other, and this is what I cherish the most in this idea of working with someone else. Teaching also is a way to pass on some knowledge, and I still do believe in it, and I do some mentoring because I think that I don't do it on a regular basis, but once in a while, and I think that it helps younger artists to open their eyes, to better know what they want. And if I can be useful on that level, I will be extremely satisfied. As an aging dancer, I decided at some point that I would take it as far as I could. So I performed, I did my last performance at 71 years old, and this was a full-length solo entitled Solo 70. Solo 70 was a celebration of my age, and a way to tell people, you know, dance is not meant to be performed only by young bodies. I think that there is a poetry in the young body, there is a beauty, but there is a poetry and a charge in the aging body that is just as beautiful. It's just different, and it's just in our habits not to pay attention to what the older one can offer artistically. And I think it's a shame. And I think that if through Solo 70, my idea was to pass on this knowledge, this idea that for younger choreographers, you can use older dancers. And to older dancers, you don't have to stop unless your body tells you to stop. Because this was my case. At 70, my body told me, that's enough. You can do other things. You can retire. When I look at those 50 years of dance, I just wish that I did feed the imagination of many spectators. I hope that I did inspire younger ones to become creators, to, although it's a difficult life, it's also a wonderful life. And so I hope that I left some positive, very positive images and attitudes for the coming generations. And I know that life is more difficult now than it was in our time. There is a bit less money. But there are so many opportunities with the new media and everything. So I have hope, and I hope that the new media will not kill the live performance. I think that we are human being and we need the live performance. And I just hope that it's the message I did pass on.
How's the mother and the red heart? Yes, she got up a sale, I mean. Yes, she got up a sale, yes. How's the mother and the red heart?